Hello, good afternoon. My name is Evan Rapport. I'd like to welcome all of you to our panel for the Dean's Honor Symposium entitled Land of the Free. I'm extraordinarily proud of these three students with whom I've been working since the beginning of the semester. In their work, they've each addressed a number of compelling issues surrounding the broadest question of freedom, and they've inspired each other as they put together today's presentation. And just a few quick thank yous. I'd like to give a special thanks to Jen Regal, who's directed the Dean's Honor Symposium with grace and generosity. Thank you, Dean. And also, I'd like to acknowledge Brett Gladstone, his group of first-year students. They came to two run-throughs of the presentation and offered important feedback. If you're here, you can stand and be recognized. So the way it's going to go is the three students are going to give their presentations on their work, and they really wanted to have an open discussion. That was sort of the focus of the of today's panel. So then there's going to be a brief break. Not an actual break, but a break in the presentations where they're going to introduce the second half of the panel, which will be an open discussion. And I was just talking with Jen and Nina, and we decided not to have like everyone on microphone and stuff like that. So it'll be sort of less formal than your usual kind of Q&A, but please stand and speak loudly when you're acknowledged to give your question. And just a final note before we begin, we will be ending promptly at 3:30 so that the next panel can set up. So thank you very much, and enjoy the panel.
So hello, everyone, and welcome to the third annual Dean's Honor Symposium. Welcome to our panel. We've worked really hard to put this together for you all, and I really hope you all enjoy it today. My name is Kevin, and I am a senior graduating this semester from the New School, and I've had the pleasure of working with Jade here, who is a sophomore and journalism and design major, and Mackenzie, who is also a sophomore doing visual studies and is a jazz vocal major. The three of us were assigned to Professor Evan Rapport, who has helped us guide our thinking and our process of creating this panel. So again, we've worked really hard for this, to put this together for you all today, and we're really happy to see you here.
At the start of the semester, the three of us here were put together seemingly at random, and it was mostly up to us to figure out how to proceed and construct our panel. And it did not take long for us to discover a common theme in our projects, the feeling of carrying shame and not being free. It's been interesting because our projects are very different, with Kevin writing a thesis paper on the Civil War of Guatemala, Mackenzie making a zine about her experience with her health, and I made a zine about coping with the death of my father. We have worked quite hard to find the intersection of our work, and I think the results, as you will soon see, are rather incredible.
As mentioned, we quickly found stigma, shame, and freedom as common themes in our projects. As such, we have created this list of words and their definitions that we wanted to show you. Please keep this all in mind while listening to our panel. It will help you understand the value and importance of our work. In the end, I know that the three of us grapple with these questions in our daily lives. Not having to think about these things is a form of privilege. The privilege of freedom, and in many ways, that privilege is absent in our lives. So please keep these points in mind. Now, without further ado, I would like to begin the presentation by starting with my project. I would also like to thank Professor Tyler Coburn, who unfortunately could not make it today, for giving me a platform to create this project. I would also like to thank my friends and faculty for coming, Jade, Kevin, and Evan for making this panel happen. But most importantly, I would like to thank my family, my beautiful mother and sister who are in the audience today. How do you explain to your three-year-old daughter why she has to prick her finger daily and take insulin shots? Or explain to her that she has an incurable disease without understanding the reasoning behind her diagnosis? This was, and still is, the reality for my family and I. Type 1 diabetes attached itself to all of us at a very young age without consent. Because I was too young to understand what was happening, my parents were forced to take personal autonomy in an effort to take charge and overcome diabetes. They had to do this to create a healthy life for all of us. Type 1 diabetes is something I will have with for the rest of my life, and with its invisibility comes a lot of stigmas. People commonly associate my disease with a lifestyle and think it's a choice and that it's preventable. This is completely false and a bit hurtful. With this idea in mind, I wanted to challenge this notion and describe my relationship to diabetes. And from this, birth a zine. The title of my zine is called The Things I Carry With Me, which is a metaphor for carrying my thoughts about my health, diabetes, my insulin pouch, and the trash accumulated from days of not properly disposing test strips or needles. Like I mentioned before, I wanted this zine to reflect my invisible disease. Based on the aesthetics of the cover, it is not apparent that this topic is about diabetes or health, just like you cannot see diabetes on me. I concluded that the likelihood of people wanting to open my zine would be successful if the cover did not apparently display my struggle with diabetes. So to start off, imagine being offered a dream vacation. And if you wanted to accept this opportunity, you would have to go in that given moment. Being diabetic, if I was given this opportunity without my diabetic stuff on hand, I would not be able to go. I wanted to then challenge the viewer to imagine that the zine were equivalent to my diabetic pouch, and they had to carry the zine with them under any circumstances. So no zine, no vacation. The physical size of my zine is parallel to the size of my pouch. And it may seem bothersome to imagine carrying something this size, but this is my reality. It is my responsibility to keep myself alive by having this on me every single day. Being diabetic, I have to check my blood sugar 10 to 15 times a day, which means pricking my finger with a mechanical needle, squeezing the blood out, and transferring it onto a meter, and then to see my results. My blood sugar should be between 90 and 140, so it seems very simple. All I have to do is check and see my results, but it's not at all. I'm constantly fighting temptations, and other factors keep distracting me. Life happens. I'm human. Not closely monitoring my blood sugar makes my levels fluctuate, and it will affect my mood tremendously. If my blood sugar is too high, I become irritable, nauseous, dehydrated, and very confused. If it's too low, I'm lethargic, tired, weak, and still very confused. Just the other day, I had an incident with my blood sugar levels, and they were extremely high. I felt that my freedom was limited because I was not in full control of my emotions or my reactions. It was debilitating. What was happening was not a true reflection of myself, and it was terrifying. The following page elaborates upon my daily schedule, with photos containing what I should eat. When I have no autonomy in my day-to-day, in the context, of course, being with diabetes, I have to adhere to a strict schedule that's purpose is to keep me alive. But that being said, I still have the agency to choose freely what foods, activities, and lifestyle choices to keep my diabetes under control. As displayed in the slide above, this is my primary mindset. Breakfast, lunch, dinner makes me think of insulin, my blood sugar, and also making some crazy mathematical equation of how I'm going to deduct my insulin as well as my blood sugar with the carbs on the back of food labels. When I wake up, I check my blood sugar, and when I go to sleep, I do the same. So it's the first and last thing I do every single day of my life. I've developed a fear of falling asleep with my blood sugar below 120 because I'm terrified of going into diabetic shock, which is a coma. Diabetic shock happens when blood sugar decreases during a sleep state. And with numbers being so low, you cannot wake yourself up. And unfortunately, this has happened to me. The photos on this slide are foods that I should avoid, but again, being human, the temptation is really hard. Sugars and carbohydrates can be extremely dangerous for me, but also are very necessary. My body converts sugar into carbohydrates to fuel my energy, just as your body does as well. My relationship to sugar feeds the stigma of type 1 diabetes and it being preventable, but it's not. I need sugar just as much as everyone else. Type 1 means my pancreas cannot provide any insulin, meaning it cannot process good or bad sugars. And this is resulting into high blood sugar. When I consume foods or liquids with high amounts of sugar, I need to give myself an insulin shot as displayed in the picture above. The things I carry with me was inspired by Adrienne Piper's My Calling Cards, specifically from her approach of distribution. It is inspired by her personal topics, as shown above, of race and gender, and how she used her art as a way of voicing these issues. Her approach, to relaying her message was with nonverbal confrontation. I took a similar approach by quietly dispersing my zine amongst individuals that found it to be aesthetically pleasing. I chose not to show my face throughout my zine because I did not want the audience to feel sympathetic for me. It was my intention to not distract the viewer from the originator in order to successfully relay my message. As for my fieldwork, again, I strategically selected environments that best fit the aesthetic. I left them at various locations around the city. I took an anthropological approach to the distribution to test the relationship between the emic and the etic. These refer to two kinds of fieldwork research completed and the collecting of the viewpoints obtained. Emic is the perspective of the subject, and etic is the perspective of the observer. This shifted the angle of the outsider to the insider, so etic to the emic, to bring social awareness to diabetes through my art. The topic of the symposium is agency and autonomy, and to be frank, it took a while for me to really correlate my experience with these two key terms. In a world where I succumb to all of the misconceptions about diabetes, I actually have no autonomy or freedom. I'm pigeonholed into what people think being a diabetic is. However, when I express myself like the way I did with the creation of the scene, I give myself autonomy and I demand it. It gives me the freedom to be able to show the world who I really am and what my struggle looks like in an artistic way. Diabetes happened to me at a very young age. And I'll never remember what it feels like not to have it, unless I look at the photo above. I was not born with it, but I was born into it. Though I have struggled with it my entire life and never had the choice of living without it, I've chosen to not let it define me. Without living with this disease, this project would have never existed. And I would never have the voice to voice my disease artistically. My intention for this project is to raise awareness about health conditions through art and its distribution. My goal is to be able to inspire people to voice their relationship to stigmas, health, and political issues the way that Adrienne Piper did for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mackenzie. That was awesome. So hello, everyone. Again, my name is Kevin. And I will be doing my presentation in Spanish because there is a lot of people in this room who do not speak English. So I have written a script to, hi mom. So I have written a script which I will be reading from my computer in Spanish, so please don't take it personally. And English speakers will be able to follow along in English on my PowerPoint.
Les digo en español que hoy día yo voy a presentar en español porque aquí hay mucha gente hoy día que no habla inglés. Entonces, los que hablen inglés pueden leer la presentación en inglés. Bueno, les voy a contar una historia sobre de Guatemala. Para empezar, Guatemala es la tierra humilde que me vio nacer en el año 1995. Y yo soy el hermano mayor en una familia que buscó refugio en los Estados Unidos. Hay muchas maneras de hacerse indocumentado en los Estados Unidos. Y una de ellas es venir con una visa turística. La visa del turista te permite entrar en este país por un máximo de 6 meses. Y si te pasas esos 6 meses, te has convertido en un indocumentado. Yo entré al país en el año 2001 y no he vuelto a salir. Ya han pasado 17 años que he vivido acá, en donde las palabras inmigrante, ilegal y extraterrestre me han convertido en criminal. Cuando yo nací, Guatemala estaba por terminar el Tratado de la Paz en un intento por finalizar la Guerra Civil, la cual empezó debido a la injerencia de los Estados Unidos desde el año 1953, bajo el mandato del entonces presidente estadounidense Dwight Eisenhower. La CIA llevó a cabo un golpe de estado en cual se derrocó al entonces presidente guatemalteco Jacobo Arbenz Guzmán. Él había ganado la presidencia en una forma democrática y justa. En su lugar, los gringos instalaron una junta militar al mando del país guatemalteco. Eso significa que tres oficiales del ejército ocuparon la posición del presidente. Eso era una dictadura militar. Muy pronto, Carlos Castillo Armas se volvió el jefe de Estado y muchos guatemaltecos se organizaron en grupos armados en contra del gobierno de facto. Ellos protestaban la injusticia que recibieron debido a la intervención estadounidense y todas las injusticias que estaban por venir aún. Las tensiones empezaron a crecer. Las tensiones empezaron a crecer en la fase de guerra civil en el año 1960. Al periodo entre 1960 y el 96 se le domina el conflicto armado, porque es cuando el gobierno militar usó una violencia extrema para eliminar cualquier persona que se opusiera al gobierno militar establecido. Durante la Guerra Fría entre los Estados Unidos y la Unión Soviética, Guatemala cargó con su parte de esa batalla debido a que los Estados Unidos estaba enfocado en exterminar al comunismo. El gobierno militar de Guatemala trabajó muy duro en el nombre de los Estados Unidos con tal de mantener su apoyo. La violencia en contra de las personas que se perciban como comunistas era el resultado de prioridades estadounidenses. Los activistas universitarios, los defensores de los indígenas y los defensores del planeta y toda persona defendiendo en contra del imperialismo estadounidense eran considerados objetivos comunistas. Con el apoyo y el permiso de los presidentes Eisenhower, Harry Truman y Richard Nixon y más, la CIA trabajó para enviar armamento, sistemas de guerra y entrenamiento al gobierno, o al ejército específicamente. Posteriormente, el gobierno de Israel también contribuyó a las injusticias en contra de los guatemaltecos. Ellos proveyeron armas de fuego y otras formas de apoyo al ejército. Entre ellas se incluye el fusil Galil. La compañía llamada Industrias Militares de Israel es la compañía que vende el Galil y el gobierno de Guatemala lo ha estado comprando desde los años 70. En el año 1978, más o menos en la misma época que empezamos a comprar el fusil Galil, Fernando Romeo Lucas García se convirtió en el presidente. Al igual que los comandantes militares anteriores, Lucas García ganó la presidencia a través del voto fraudulento. Bajo su mandato presidencial, la violencia en contra de los ciudadanos ordinarios se intensificó drásticamente, y eventualmente se produjo una masacre en la ciudad capital en 1980. Cuando un grupo de manifestantes indígenas y sus aliados tomaron la embajada de España en la ciudad de Guatemala, la Policía Nacional respondió. La Policía Nacional tenía capacidad militar y siempre trabajaba en el nombre del ejército. Ellos acordonaron la embajada en un intento por eliminar a los protestantes, lo cual no funcionó. Entonces fue cuando decidieron sellar todas las salidas del edificio y le prendieron fuego con todos adentros, manifestantes y trabajadores de la Embajada Española. Cuando los bomberos llegaron a rescatar a la gente, la policía les negó el paso hasta que las llamas empezaron a calmarse por sí mismas. Ese día murieron 36 personas, incluyendo el padre de Rigoberta Menchú, una mujer activista de los derechos indígenas perteneciente a la etnia quiché, que se ganó el Premio Nobel de la Paz en el 92 en reconocimiento por su trabajo en la justicia social. Bajo el general Lucas García, cualquier persona que hiciera sus demostraciones públicas en contra del régimen militar era considerado un objetivo para su eliminación. 2 años después del incendio en la Embajada Española, Lucas García fue removido de la presidencia por otro golpe de Estado, nuevamente por un movimiento militar encabezado por José Efraín Ríos Montt. Él perfeccionó sus esfuerzos por eliminar a los comunistas, pues según que la violencia de Lucas García había sido errática y casi al azar, por lo que Ríos Montt empezó con la táctica denominada de tierra chamuscada o de tierra quemada, causando el genocidio de la población guatemalteca. El presidente estadounidense Ronald Reagan visitó Guatemala justo en ese momento, y al regresar a los Estados Unidos, presionó al Congreso para enviar más ayuda militar a Ríos Montt, con la excusa que Ríos Montt era un hombre de honor totalmente dedicado a la democracia. Es posible que Reagan era el fanático número uno de Ríos Montt. Ríos Montt representa el periodo más violento de la historia reciente de Guatemala. Más de 200,000 muertos aparecieron en agujeros en la tierra y 626 pueblos han sido exterminados. Hay lugares en Guatemala que eran hogar para las personas que hoy están completamente vacíos. Y para darles un ejemplo, Dos Erres era un pueblecito en la aldea La Libertad del departamento El Petén, norte de Guatemala. Hoy día, Dos Erres no existe ni en el mapa del internet. Es nada más que un campo donde las vacas pueden ir a pastar de vez en cuando. Cuando el conflicto armado terminó, yo apenas tenía un añito. Pronto nació mi hermano. Mis padres crecieron durante el conflicto armado, completamente de milagro sobrevivieron y tenían la obligación de criar a dos hijos en un país bien chamuscado. Allá no existe la posibilidad de obtener una educación superior ni trabajo debido a la pobreza extrema causada por los Estados Unidos. Y la violencia se convirtió en el pan de cada día después de la guerra. Con esto en mente, es lógico buscar una salida. Hoy en día hablamos de la inmigración como que si fuese una opción. Pero si las opciones están entre quedarse en perpetua miseria o si existiría la mínima oportunidad de escapar a esa miseria, entonces, ¿dónde está la opción? ¿Cómo no va a ser forzada? Y forzada a un territorio extranjero, donde me encuentro criminalizado junto a 11 millones de indocumentados presentes en el país. Y cuando eres criminalizado bajo estas circunstancias, ¿cómo es posible sentirse uno a salvo con las instituciones que se suponen que lo mantienen a uno seguro, la seguridad pública? En esencia, se siente como que si la policía está ahí para resguardar a la población en general de alguien como yo, el criminal ilegal. ¿Cómo entonces quieren que yo me sienta salvo cuando vemos a los policías armados con fusiles M16 en la Grand Central, o en Union Square, o en Times Square, o en donde sea? ¿Cómo se supone que la policía me va a hacer sentir a salvo a mí y a los 11 millones como yo? Imposible. La persona quien yo soy es el resultado de la relación histórica entre Guatemala y los Estados Unidos, la sociedad que a cada rato se hace más militarizado, mi estatus indocumentado y también mi familia. Es fácil observar las injusticias creadas por sistemas que favorecen a las personas de piel blanca, al patriarcado y a los que tienen dinero. Y lo que a mí no me agrada es cuando la gente observa esas injusticias y escogen voltear la cabeza. Incluso existen aquellos que se mienten a sí mismos, se dicen que son neutros y que no son ni parte del problema ni la solución. Pero si vos sos alguien que es neutro, entonces tú eres la persona que simple y sencillamente observó a Ríos Montt exterminar a la gente guatemalteca. Eres alguien que está observando a Barack Obama detener, deportar y separar más familias. Y eres alguien que sigue rascándose la cabeza mientras que Donald Trump hace normal la violencia en contra de la mujer, el racismo y el odio cada minuto de cada día en la televisión. Yo no puedo ser así. Yo cuando era muy pequeño quería ser un cirujano. Y para ese entonces yo desconocía del mundo y aún tenía la libertad de construir mi futuro con mi imaginación. Cuando empecé a crecer, entendí que yo tenía que ser un doctor, pero en cambio para el planeta, que se envenena con las maldades de las personas. Yo soy un organizador, educador y un activista. Y yo dedico mi tiempo para empoderar a la gente de mi comunidad. Hago muchos trabajos, incluyendo servicios directos, y eso significa llenando aplicaciones, haciendo llamadas telefónicas y buscando trabajos para la gente. Y también participo en organizaciones que buscan crear cambios en leyes de nuestro gobierno. Un lugar, por ejemplo, donde yo actualmente trabajo es el Consejo de Liderazgo Juvenil de Nueva York. Y ahí está nuestro logo. Ahí es donde empecé mi trabajo político, trabajando para pasar el Acto del Sueño, el Dream Act, de Nueva York, desde que estaba en la secundaria. Nosotros hemos ido a Albany para hablar con los políticos para pasar esa ley, y en ese preciso momento era donde encontré mi afinidad con la comunidad inmigrante y su lucha. Desde esos días, empecé a practicar las habilidades que necesito para arreglar los problemas que veo yo en el mundo. La visión que yo tengo para un mejor futuro de nuestro mundo no es simplemente uno donde nadie ni yo le tenga miedo a los agentes armados. Yo quiero un planeta donde la policía y el ejército no tengan ningún lugar para empezar. Para terminar, les quiero acordar que no vean a esta historia ni con felicidad ni con alegría. No porque tengo una educación, ni porque tengo trabajo, ni porque estoy haciendo dinero, ni nada. Acuérdense que esta es una historia sobre de Guatemala. Y mi presencia en este país es nada más que otro ejemplo de la manera en que los Estados Unidos se aprovecha del planeta. En Guatemala, aquellos como yo que se dedican al trabajo social enfrentan muchos peligros, incluyendo amenazas de muerte. Y si yo estuviera allá, cambiando ese clima de miedo sería una de las prioridades de mi vida. Pero yo no estoy allá porque los Estados Unidos me robó desde muy pequeño, desde muy tierno de la tierra, con la intención de explotarme acá, para sacar buen provecho de mi labor, de mi vida, y no compensarme de una manera justa. Y la evidencia de eso la tienen aquí enfrente de ustedes. Después de 17 años de vivir acá en este país, siendo un beneficiario del programa DACA, o sea, no criminal, supuestamente, aún no tengo ni el privilegio ni el derecho a residencia estadounidense. Muchas gracias por escuchar y les presento a Jay.
Wow, Kevin. Awesome. It was a privilege to see you two and your how much progress you all made within like such a short amount of time. So thank you guys. Okay. So hi, everybody. My name is Jade, and as mentioned before, I'm a sophomore, I'm a journalism and design major. And I just want to thank a couple people before I begin. I would like to thank my grandmother and my uncle and my best friend, Gabby, who are all here today. My amazing professor, Rebecca Riley, who's here. And I believe my other professor is in attendance, Anu Kiranaya. Oh, there you are. Hi. And anybody else, I can't really tell who else is here that I may or may not know. So we're just going to keep on going. And Evan, of course. But before I begin, I would just like to have a content warning. I'm going to be talking about drugs and death. So if anybody at all feels uncomfortable, you are welcome to leave at this moment. I remember talking to two friends of mine when I was a child. They learned to be ambidextrous. When they asked me why I couldn't write with my left hand, I explained that when I was younger, my father and I used to live in South Africa. I remember he was holding me by the hand and we were trekking through this deep, beautiful jungle until we came across a mother tiger and her young. I remember she locked eyes with me and she reached her claw out, cutting my left hand. My father killed a tiger with a shotgun. In the stories I told my friends after that, my father was a heroic police officer who fought for justice with nothing but a pair of silver handcuffs. He was an artist, a writer, and a businessman. In actuality, my father was a heroin addict. He was murdered in a failed drug deal with two shots to the head and the chest. And they never found who did it since no one could come to the police lineup. When I was in the fourth grade, I received a telescope. I could not see much in the polluted New Jersey sky except for the occasional satellite. When I saw a star, I took it as a sign that my father was saying hello, breathing through his spacesuit and floating around aimlessly. I decided my father was an astronaut, hence the title of my project, Conversations with an Astronaut. The inspiration for this project, philosopher and mathematician Ludwig Wittgenstein believed that through a series of numbered propositions, one can bring together individual logical operations. So for example, if my first proposition is that I saw a dog and my second proposition is that I saw a cat, by the last proposition, you'll be able to get a rough idea of why I brought up seeing that cat and dog. Although sometimes his work did not come to those abrupt conclusions. My project is loosely based on these propositions, which I worked on closely under the supervision of my professor, Rebecca Riley. Spread out over 28 propositions, I finally come forward with who my father really was, telling the story that he deserved without tiger killings and grand arrests, but rather his life as the one being killed and arrested. I wish my father had a chance to state his case, so I'm giving him a voice. We often hear of grief that is fresh, but what about my grief that has sustained over 10 years? I explore the intersections of my grief with other areas of my life as a way to reassure the young me. The first page says, dedicated to a younger Jade. It is not your fault. It was never your fault. In a way, this project is also for myself. I'm finally being allowed to experience the pain I could not express. This is a love letter to us both. In addition to the propositions, I've created a zine, a mini magazine, featuring original collages and Polaroids. Working closely with my other professor, Anya Kiranaya, I have been able to become comfortable sharing his story, our story, with all of you. My father had no agency, no access. He was a Puerto Rican immigrant from the projects. He dropped out of high school and alternated between selling stolen items, selling drugs, robbing people. He escaped hospital rooms with armed police officers outside waiting for his arrest once he came to consciousness. He would bang on the door of his house and not be allowed in, instead having the sheriff called down to rearrest him. My father never had a chance at rehabilitation because he was not deemed an ideal citizen. The access of rehabilitation for drug addicts is often expensive, with the only temporary relief found within a cell. Comprehensive treatment and residency can run upwards of tens of thousands of dollars. My father always wished to become clean, but he was never given that chance. He was left to repeat the cycle. My own mother is still dependent on methadone, a drug used to manage opioid addiction. While only recommended for short-term use, she has been dependent upon it for over 10 years, costing hundreds of dollars. But she has been sober for a number of years now, and for that, I am thankful. I have a fond memory of laying in bed with my mother, and she was asking me for ideas for a new tattoo. I brought up the Serenity Prayer, which graced the back of my father's prayer card from his funeral. She laughed, and she told me only drug addicts use that prayer. God grant me the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change, like the loss of my father and my innocence. Courage to change the things that I can, like the subsequent mental health issues, the failing relationship with my mother, and the process of my grief. And the wisdom to know the difference, which is something I still struggle with to this day. I grew up with a heavy shame surrounding me. I went to sweet 16s and saw girls dancing with their fathers who had no track marks on their arms. I visited my father once a year at his grave. I was relentlessly teased for something that I did not choose. I became known as the crackhead's daughter, the girl with the dead dad, the girl destined to repeat this path. I had a fear of swallowing pills for fear of addiction that I only got over 2 years ago. I continue to have, I even began receiving his life insurance money to use toward my college education. And as I deposit the money every year on my birthday, I feel a sense of dread as if I was setting myself up for disappointment. My entire existence has been compartmentalized to avoid being associated with these perceptions. I'm hypervisible within my mind, and those like my father stay invisible in this world. We abandon them and we abandon their kin, only keeping the poster children of morality. My father can be seen as the poster child of a man who took advantage of the only options offered to him, doing only what he knew. His lifestyle was out of necessity, not by choice. I did not choose his life for myself. I carved spaces of freedom for myself and childlike fantasies of him being an astronaut or a heroic policeman. My father found freedom in the streets where the world did not judge him. He was a father, he loved space, he listened to Nine Inch Nails and he wrote poetry. He was a dreamer, a lover, and he was a hell of a fighter. He was Ricardo Gomez, not just another statistic. The love for my father reverberates to this day, and I continue to learn more things about him. Just a few weeks ago, a friend of his contacted me with a photo I've never seen before. And it's the first photo I've ever seen where he's smiling. I choose to remember him in this way, regardless of what was in his system. This is who he was. As we think about the lack of sensitivity toward these marginalized people and these systems, I want to end with Wittgenstein's final proposition of his 1921 Tractatus Logico Philosophicus, where if one cannot speak, thereof one must be silent. Thank you. So now we will proceed to the second half of our panel with a clip of esteemed jazz singer Nina Simone discussing her own take on freedom. Thank you.
Well, what's freedom?
What's freedom mean?
Yeah.
Same thing it is to you. You tell me.
No, you tell me. No. Because I've been talking for such
a long
time.
It's just a feeling. It's like, how do you tell somebody how it feels to be in love? How are you going to tell anybody who has not been in love how it feels to be in love? You cannot do it to save your life. You can describe things, but you can't tell them. But you know it when it happens. That's what I mean by free. I've had a couple of times on stage when I really felt free, and that's something else. That's really something else. Like like, I'll tell you what freedom is to me. No fear. I mean, really, no fear. If I could have that half of my life, no fear. Lots of children have no fear. That's the closest way, that's the only way I can describe it. That's not all of it, but it is something to really, really feel.
Have you like, no. I've noticed
like this. A new way of seeing. A new way of seeing something.
So again, Nina Simone is a singer, a songwriter, and a pivotal activist during the civil rights movement. Her words resonated with us from her definition of freedom and its binary of fear. We would like to take this moment to now open the panel discussion by returning to the questions and key terms that were earlier introduced. And I guess I'll begin with the question, how do you feel free? If I were to be asked this question 10 years ago, I would say probably not being diabetic. Since I didn't quite understand what that was being 3 years old, I didn't think that was being free at all. Now freedom means being able to control and cope my disease. I'm still facing issues every day. I mean, even when we were meeting up for this panel, I would have to not go to one of the presentations or rehearsals because I had to see my endocrinologist. And that was very debilitating again because I didn't feel free or able to meet up with people just because of my health restrictions. So
when do you feel free? I have a slightly different approach to it, being that, and I was talking about it with them earlier, is that freedom within grief does not really exist. And for me, I find small glimpses of freedom when I forget about these things, but overall, just the heavy shame surrounding me and just, as I said in my presentation, constantly trying to change my existence so that people won't be able to read this about me. It's different. And as we talked about within all of our presentations, freedom in itself is a privilege. And there are some people in this world who do not feel free. So for me, for example, as a woman of color, I already am not free in certain spaces. And it goes for the same for both of you within the different intersections of class, race, and all these other life experiences. So I feel like it truly is a privilege to feel free and not have any worry at all. And it again, depends on the situation, the time and place, and the space that you take up, and everything else.
How do I feel free? I think it's a lot of work trying to feel free. It's a lot of work because I'm constantly aware of the things that would make me not free. I have to be constantly aware of my posture. I have to be constantly worried that if I put my hoodie on, I might become a suspect in something around me that has nothing to do with me. I'm constantly aware that if I get stopped, say pulled over, which I have a driver's license, but if I get pulled over, I'm going to get harassed because my license says temporary visitor contingent on DACA. So it's a lot of work trying to be free despite, because you can't separate your reality from what you want to be. And so when you're trying to feel free with it, you can never feel free really within that context. I think that for me personally, I can only ever have like the illusion of it because I can tell myself, well, I'm going to school, I have a job, I'm saving money. Like I can tell myself anything I want and I can kind of feel free. But then I think about it and I think about, like we said, the intersections, and it's like, well, I still go to an institution that's very white dominated and it's a very, very white space. And sometimes as a person of color in the new school, I haven't felt safe as a person of color. In my workplaces, same deal. It's very white dominated. The Youth Leadership Council specifically are women of color who lead, organize, and otherwise run it. I'm probably one or two of our staff members who are men. And that's a space where I actually feel free, because that's a space that is, that seems to be divorced from everything else that polices your activity, that polices your life. And as soon as I step out of those doors at 168 Canal Street, which is our office, I'm back into the world, and I'm back to worrying about the hoodie and worrying about my license and worrying about how I walk and worry about whether I look funny and so on. So I don't know if I can ever really feel free and actually be genuine freedom. As we said, it's a privilege that I don't have.
And I think to go into the other question about fear, I think we all felt that there's this parallel between freedom and fear, whereas I have it with my blood sugar. If it's out of line, if I go into diabetic shock, if I don't have my insulin with me, I know for Jade, falling into, if you can hear me, falling into your father's footsteps, as well as being undocumented. And I think these are things that we struggle in our daily lives. And I'm sure that plenty of you have freedom and fear that you think about every day. And it's kind of just a normal mindset, I think, at this point for all of us. And we've kind of realized that for this presentation.
And going to the second question, how do you create spaces of freedom? Which is one interesting development that we discovered only within like the last 2 or 3 weeks, especially thinking about the Nina Simone clip, because I was specifically thinking about her point that the only people that don't have fear are children. And it was something that we all related to, in a sense that, we weren't aware of these things that were happening. We weren't conscious of these the impacts that these events had on our lives. And I was specifically thinking, aside from what I talked about in my presentation, in which I created like these fantasies of to try to cope with my father's death. Like, for example, when I was younger, I remember on Father's Day, for example, so because we would end school later, like in June, so we would all come together and make Father's Day cards. And I always had to be the kid who raised my hand and say, what am I supposed to do? I don't have a father. And I had a lot of teachers just say, so just go in the corner and just color, do something and just wait. And I remember when I was in the fourth grade, I told my computer teacher this because we were learning to make like little e-cards and stuff. And she was like, how about you write an actual letter to him? And that was like the first and only time in my academic life as a kid where someone understood. And I created space of freedom for myself within that, just by having other people understand what I was going through and allowing me the space to grieve, in which I could create that temporary moment of freedom. Because grief is like so heavily, and like shame is so heavily stigmatized in society, and we're told not to experience these things, especially in public, for fear of making people uncomfortable. And I think those few people who understand, they really helped me a lot.
I would like to really, if I could, I used to want to be a surgeon, which is what I said during my presentation, that when I was very young, and my imagination still had the freedom to create my future for me, that I wanted to be a surgeon. I wanted to operate on people. And that was my dream career when I was a kid. And I think that now my dream job, which is something I try to work towards every day, especially in my work through YLC, is to decolonize, to create freedom through decolonization. Because, for example, with the example of YLC, that is a space where you will only ever feel shame for putting women down, for example. Which is something you should feel shame for, by the way. And so when you create, so when you talk about creating freedom, you have to talk also about decolonizing, because you have to deconstruct what's already there to create space for what needs to be. The two cannot coexist. You cannot coexist. Patriarchy, for example, the system of privilege, for those that don't know, is a system of privileges that favors men and male presenting people at the expense of women. You cannot create a system of equality. You cannot dream of equality or equity if patriarchy still exists. And even worse, if you continue to hide it and if you continue to deny it exists. So when I feel free is moments when I'm decolonizing. It's moments like today when I do a presentation in Spanish as opposed to English. Yeah, see, I heard them. that's how I feel. That's how I feel free, when you decolonize. Yeah, we'd like to open it now, I guess, for questions, comments. We'd like to hear from you. Does anyone have anything they'd like to say?
Speak loudly. different day. And I think it'd be interesting to see and move forward and what's happening in the country with the opioid epidemic, how there's going to be that shift in who's the student, that the person that looks like you, who's the kid that doesn't have a father, that doesn't look like you, you know, and how that's going to, that perception is going to change, because it's going to have to change because of the epidemic that the country's going through.
Definitely,
it'd
yes.
be interesting to see in academia what comes out of that too, you know, and just, you know, I'm sure there'll be many people researching this topic. It'd be interesting to see, you know.
Definitely, yes. And yeah, thinking about how this current administration is, like, especially as of recently, Trump has announced that considering cutting welfare for people who have drugs in their system, and considering like death penalty for drug dealers and all that stuff, and just constantly thinking about how the stigma is still in place and how things are constantly changing, especially with the heavy police state that we are being under, with the heavy surveillance in which we are all not alone, and yeah, the perceptions of such, and how I myself and many other people are working within their respective fields to change such a thing. So thank you.
Can I say something on that too, Jay?
Yeah.
I also want to point out that you don't really have to be an academic, and you don't really need an extensive amount of research to realize that there is a huge difference in how we treat opioid addiction in the suburbs and how we treat crack addiction in the hood. There's a giant difference there. And I think, again, as far as decolonizing academia, you don't have to be an academic for that. You just got to listen to Black voices. Thank you.
I read a book that was important to me recently that is fundamentally about economics in a way that was surprising to me. We're talking about freedom and who benefits, maybe in part, from lack of freedom to certain, say, parts of the population, or certain parts of the world, or certain parts of even the planet. And that book was by Naomi Klein, and it was called Shock Doctrine. And I can't recommend it highly enough for connecting economics to so much of the inequality of freedom in all of these areas, and then some. Shock Doctrine.
She wrote this beautiful series of poetic compositions about her dad and her grief and how that marked her life. Just seeing all of you up there, like how you create space for freedom, like I think of Jade as this like spiritual warrior against shame. And like the title of your zine was like The Things We Carry, and I think you guys all created space for freedom because you're like, you're not gonna carry this alone. Like if you open it up and show it to people, and like, so Jade's work really did that for our class, and we all like get in touch with our own feelings and humanity, shame, like pride. And it was, you know, it's just one of the most beautiful things I've ever read. But all of you guys, I feel like, shared that deep private space with other people. But it's like shame is something you hide, but you all used it to create space for freedom. So do you want to say about shame or?
Well, I think kind of going off
your point, I don't think we said it enough. Like we have the freedom to make these projects because of Eugene Lang. If we weren't in the symposium, I don't think any of us would be able to talk about our relationship to shame and these stigmas that we each carry. And we can't thank this school enough for allowing us to have this platform to do this. But I mean, definitely, I think what was interesting about this project is starting with, I guess my project was kind of the body, like the shame that I inherited from being young and not understanding why I couldn't have cotton candy opposed to my fellow classmates or even my sister, you know, just little things like that. And then going into kind of the outer shell of being shamed for your skin color or because you have been transported from a country to country or because of the reputation you bring. So I think that, yeah, without having the symposium, we wouldn't be able to express it. But I think that it was a common ground that we kind of realized after we started talking about these issues, where we thought it was just personal narrative, which goes into the shame, but
Yeah, and I think that's important because shame is a very powerful, if not the most, one of the most powerful tools of repression and colonization historically. We shame, in the present day, we shame black and brown bodies. We shame Black Lives Matter. We shame fat bodies. We shame any number of things and people and existences that don't adhere to what is assimilated, to what is default. And so I can't help but, when we're talking about shame, I can't help but be reminded of a tidbit of a story with my grandmother, who is present in the audience today, where one day we went to, long story short, we were invited to a birthday party of one of my friends, and it was a very white space because my friend is a white woman. So we went, and it was very white, and she, you know, no one like said to her, hey, you know, keep your head down. No one actually said that to her physically. No one, you know, embodied that even. But just the internalization of shame around white bodies because you are not one is so strong that she is someone who walked in with her head down. And so my work in that moment to decolonize became to make her feel proud of who she was. And I did that by whenever somebody came to our table where we were, every time someone came to say hi to me, I said, hi, my name is Kevin, and this is my mom and my grandmother and my aunt and my uncle and my dad and so on and so on and so on. And I did it for every single time because you had to. And soon enough, she was fine. She was chilling. She was no longer shame. She was like, hey, can I get more food? Is there like another one? Because that's the power we have through decolonization. I'm going to say it really quick in Spanish because it's not fair that I said it in English and she don't speak English. La vergüenza es una herramienta muy poderosa que se ha usado para mantener a la gente abajo, para mantener a la gente en sufrimiento y en opresión. Y es nuestro trabajo de quitar eso del mundo, de la vergüenza. Yo me acuerdo una vez que nos invitaron a una fiesta de cumpleaños y, de mi amiga, que es una mujer blanca de piel. Y yo fui con mi mamá, mi abuela, mi tía y toda mi gente, los que están todos aquí en esta parte. entonces fuimos y yo me di cuenta que cuando entramos, como había tanta gente blanca, de color blanca alrededor, nadie le dijo a mi abuela que se sienta mal, que se agache la cabeza, que como sea. Pero sin embargo, ella se sintió avergonzada. Yo vi que ella se agachaba la cabeza, no hablaba, le daba como cosa. Entonces yo en ese momento, mi trabajo era de decolonizar. Entonces, cada vez, por ejemplo, cuando venía alguien a saludarme a mí y solo a mí a la mesa, porque no tocaba a mi familia, como para ellos eran invisibles, solo a mí y that's it. Entonces yo, en cambio, decía, hola, yo me llamo Kevin, y esta es mi mamá, y esta es mi tía, y esta es mi abuela, y este es mi tío, y fulano, sutano, mengano. Y así fuimos. Y de repente, vean que de repente ya mi familia perdió la vergüenza, y mi abuelita, en cambio, estaría avergonzada, que no puede. No, dijo, mucha, ¿hay más comida por ahí? ¿O será que se sirve uno? ¿Cómo va a ser? Entonces, eso es lo que les quiero contar. Eso es nuestro trabajo y no es nada del otro mundo. Todos lo podemos hacer, solo tenemos que entender el poder de nuestras palabras.
Okay, so this is my Aunt Fanny, and she's asking us a question in Spanish, and what she asked me was if I
had the opportunity, given what I've experienced in Guatemala, knowing the history and knowing that country and knowing all these things about Guatemala and knowing what I know here, given the chance, would I return? The first part of that question, I don't know anything about Guatemala because I left when I was 5 years old. So I don't, and I've never been back. So I have no idea. When people meet me, they tell me, wow, they can guess anything. They'll say, where are you from? I'd say guess, and they'll say Colombia. United Arab Emirates. I'm like, no, I'm from Guatemala. And people say something like, wow, you don't look anything like a Guatemalan. And I'm like, thanks, I know. Like, I'm aware, that's what assimilation does to you. So the first part of that question, I don't even know Guatemala, to be honest. I don't have a relationship with Guatemala beyond my own family. Would I go back? Absolutely, I'd love to, I want to see the land. I want to get to know the land that saw my birth. How do you not think it's frustrating for me to sit here and know? I can tell you, yeah, the BDFM is on 6th Avenue. I know the L train goes 14th Street. If you're on 42nd Street, you ride the 7. I can tell you all these things about New York City. I can tell you about Manhattan, Queens, Brooklyn, the Bronx, Westchester, and Staten Island between, you get my point. I cannot tell you the first thing about Guatemala. I know we have a Zone 1, which probably serves as our version of Midtown, and beyond that, I don't know anything. So yes, I would return, mostly because I don't know my country. En español. Decolonizing is hard work, y'all. It's not easy. En español. Entonces, si pudiese regresar a Guatemala, para empezar, yo no conocía Guatemala porque me salí muy, muy, muy joven, a los 5 años, y no he regresado. Entonces, yo ni conozco de Guatemala. Aquí te puedo decir de los trenes, de los subways, del Metro North, de la 95 que trae aquí de Bridgeport. Te puedo decir cualquier cosa de Nueva York, de Connecticut, de Nueva Jersey, de Pensilvania. Todo te puedo decir yo aquí. Pero de Guatemala, lo único que yo sé es que hay una zona 1, y eso es más o menos el centro de la ciudad, y de ahí, no sé. Entonces, para empezar, yo no conozco a Guatemala. Yo no tengo una relación con Guatemala, más allá de mi familia que está presente conmigo. Entonces, si yo regresaría, por supuesto, yo quisiera regresar. Yo quiero conocer la tierra donde yo nací, que me vio nacer. Quiero ver el efecto de la colonización de los Estados Unidos e internacionalmente en Guatemala. Quiero verlo con mis ojos. Me muero por conocerlo. Pero como yo estoy tan, mi vida está tan hecha aquí, yo no puedo regresar, allá no hay nada para mí.
Feel really lucky to be in this room in this moment of freedom, being here. I'm so motivated and inspired by all three of you. And I just am really impressed with all of your composure and how you guys were able to tell your stories. And, you know, just, I think we can all say we're all just really proud and grateful to be here with you and share this moment.
Thanks, Kiki.
Did we create freedom in here?
Again, I'm really proud. I am of all three. This was such a wonderful panel. Thank you all so much for coming. Just one more round of applause for these three amazing people.